You know, when I wrote that song and asked Luke to sing it, I just had no idea. No, those two wrote that. Crazy. Talented. And it's all of it. Well, hi, everybody. How are you? Welcome to our online audience. We're so glad you're joining us. We've been in this series that we're calling Happy. Everybody say happy. And today we're going to talk about a happy spirit. You know, in our culture, we talk a lot about intellect, the mind, our thinking, and our bodies, what we eat and how much we work out or don't work out. But we don't talk a lot about spirit. So today I want to talk about the Holy Spirit. This week somebody asked me, new Jesus person, they asked me, you mentioned the Holy Spirit. What is it? And I love the freshness of that question. First of all, it's important to know it's not an it, it's a person, right? The Holy Spirit's a person. Now, if you didn't know that, it's okay, because I was studying for the ministry before I ever figured out the Holy Spirit was a person. I used to live next door to a witch. And I didn't even know it. Some of you are like, I used to be married to one. No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about an actual witch. And that was a little divorce joke for some of you who missed it. And one day I went over to her house. Something had happened. She lived right next door to me. In the North End over there. And I said, hey, I couldn't help but notice this. It was kind of, I had another reason for going over there, but what I really wanted to know, what I was about to ask her about, was in every window, she had a little piece of a broken mirror. And so, I went over there and made it with my made-up reason. And I said, hey, by the way, I couldn't help but notice that, like, in every window, you have a little piece of a broken mirror there. And she said, yeah. You know how people make you work for it? I'm like, what's that about? She says, well, I'm a witch, a white witch, I think she called herself. And we believe that that's how you keep bad spirits out. Or I understand that in our Native American traditions, they have ideas about how you keep bad spirits out. I think in the Japanese tradition, their architecture, isn't it so that when you see the roof lines in some of those cultures, they have those swooping roof lines, that's all about keeping bad spirits out. But in our culture, we don't talk about spirits much. Good or bad. But you are a spirit. And you can feel. Can you not feel when somebody has a heavy spirit? When they walk in and they have we might call it depressed. But depressed is a way of putting a clinical title on something. I'm not talking about the clinical. I'm talking about the spiritual. Somebody say, I get it, right? Because doctors will try to put a label on something that really isn't a medical problem. It's a spiritual problem. So today I want to talk about not the artificial spirit, not a counterfeit spirit, not an evil spirit that you're trying to get away from, not something you want to put little mirrors in your window so that it doesn't come by you, but something, if you're a Jesus person, we believe the person of Jesus, his spirit, comes in you, and you want it. And the exercise of the Holy Spirit is just our getting comfortable with the spirit that's been in you since the moment you said yes to Jesus, to get him out of you and into this world. Here's what Jesus himself said. about the Holy Spirit. Can I read you something? I'd like to see you try to stop me. Jesus says, John chapter 14, you know, there's lots to say about the Holy Spirit. If you're going to start somewhere, start with Jesus. It's His Spirit. Don't you want to know? I mean, if you're going to buy a car from somebody, don't you want to talk to the guy who owns it? If you want to talk about my son, don't you want to talk to the dad? So I appreciate what you can read in other books of the Bible about the Holy Spirit. I want to know what Jesus says, because I'm here for Jesus. Somebody else say amen. So Jesus, in Matthew chapter 14, is talking to some of his followers, his disciples, his core group. And he's about to go into a crucifixion and a resurrection. And ultimately, an ascension. He's lifting off here in no time. So they're worried about what happens after you die. And Jesus says, don't worry. This is from the Passion Translation. Or surrender to your fear. We've been there before, haven't we? For you believed in God, now trust in and believe in me also. What you're going to see in Jesus' conversation here, I want you to look for this, is I want you to look for the increased personalization of God. Jesus says, you believed that there is a God way out there? Now I want you to believe in me, God in a body. Okay? But it gets even more personal. It goes on and says, he explained, I'm the way, the truth, the life. Nobody, no one comes to the Father except through me, through union with me. To know me is to know my Father. Now, sometimes people get lost in these sentences because they're like, you're the Father, Just watch the personalization. This is a personalization passage. He says, if you want to know what he looks like, if you want to know what he acts like, if you want to know what he wants, you can look at what I act like, what I want. If you want to know how to please him, think about how I've been pleased. If you want to know what he can do, Jesus says, think of what I can do. To know me is to know my Father. And from now on, you will realize you've seen him and you've experienced him. And now he starts to segue into even more personal realization of Jesus. Because it's not God out there somewhere. It's not even God in a body. This is God in your body. The Holy Spirit is God living in you, Jesus living in you. I tell you this timeless truth, a person who follows me in faith, believing in me, will do the same mighty miracles I do. Like when you read that, Jesus says, another translation, it says, everything you've seen me do, you're going to do only more and better. Don't you kind of wonder how that happens? He's about to tell him that you can do more and better because he's going to be in you. He's not just alongside you, right? For I will do whatever you ask me to do when you ask in my name, and that's how the Son will show that the Father is really like and bring glory to him. Ask me anything in my name and I will do it for you. Loving me empowers you to obey my commands. And I ask the Father and he will give you another Savior, the Holy Spirit of truth. I love this translation, the way he translates, because the word there in Greek is a word paraclete. And a paraclete basically means rescuer or comforter if you're totally have lost it, or counselor or physician. But they translate it Savior there because it's basically he's saying he's going to be just like me. The Holy Spirit will be a friend just like me. He will never leave you. The world won't receive him. So he's not going to be super popular because they can't see him or know him. But you know him intimately because he remains with you and will live inside you. I promise that I will never leave you helpless or abandon you as orphans. I will come back to you. Let me dive out of that there. Do you guys have Netflix? So let me explain what Netflix is to some of you. No, I'm kidding. I'm an explainer. I can't help myself. The other night, I was flipping around and everybody was asleep. That doesn't mean a lot. It wasn't 2 a.m. The women in my house go to bed at 7:15, okay? Kind of lightweights. But that's another story. So I'm flipping around and I find a movie. It's called King Arthur. What? I kind of know King Arthur's story. Camelot. Arthur is this great king. This one was made by Guy Ritchie, and it's got a little twist to it. And the twist goes like this. Arthur, his father is the king, and he is killed by an evil rival. And his sword, which holds magical powers in it, has been fused into the middle of a rock, and only the king or an heir to his throne can have the power to take Excalibur's sword out of that rock and lead the people back to prosperity. But this kid, his father, the king, was murdered when he was just a baby. And in order to hide him from the evil rival, they give him to a group of prostitutes living in a brothel. And this, now fast forward, are you with me? Picture movies, music, you know, chop cuts, all that stuff. Drama, drama, drama. Then handsome Arthur comes. Good-looking guy, looks a lot like me, shorter hair, and he doesn't know he's the king. So there's word. There's like a prophecy. There's a rumbling in the invisible, and the rival, the evil rival, says, somewhere the king's son has grown into a man, and he's ready to take the throne. We gotta find this guy and kill him before he realizes who he is. So they go all throughout the land. This is called a spoiler alert for Netflix. Some of you are like, you can leave now before. So they go to find this kid, and they find this thug who was raised in a brothel. And they drag him out, put him in line to find out. And he's totally nonchalant. And he doesn't care about any of this foolishness. He just wants to go home. He just wants to get back to work. And he puts his hand on the sword. And something in the sword connects with something in him. Because there was a promise he knew nothing about. And it blew him away, frightened everyone around him, and it released the sword by the touch of his hand. The evil rival grabs him, throws him in prison, and he's so happy he's going to kill King Arthur before he even gets started. And this evil rival says, who do you think you are? I'm gonna destroy you. And he says, I'm the bastard son of a prostitute born in a brothel. And this evil king says, I know who you are. You're the son of the great king. And like for the first third, this kid doesn't even know what's in him. And it comes to the point where he wants to give it all. He doesn't want to play these games. He doesn't want to be, he doesn't know anything about what happened before. All he knows is about his life here and now. And then the forces of evil keep attacking him. And he wakes up one day and he says, there must be something to it. Otherwise, they wouldn't be so anxious to kill me. Now, let me just pause right there and say, I'm not trying to get you to subscribe to Netflix, okay? And I'm not trying to spoil a movie for you. When I saw it, I had tears rolling down my face. Because that's my experience. I meet people all the time. And you know what they say to me? I'm nobody. I'm no big deal. I'm not me. I mean, you're like, they're like, wouldn't it be cool? If I could write a song like Luke, if I could sing like Tracy, well, you know, if I could talk like you, if I was an author, maybe if I was the money of Bill Gates. No, no, no. No, no, things have happened before you ever were on the scene. And things were spoken over you and planted into you. And until you put your hand on the sword, you don't know what's in you, man. This is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the part of you that the minute you become a Jesus person, it's in you, and you activate it by faith. And when you live that out, it has all kinds of functions. It's not just about battle, but it makes you ready for battle. The Holy Spirit in you is why the devil hates you. It's why the devil wants to destroy your marriages. It's why he wants to destroy your kids. It's why the devil goes after 16-year-olds trying to get them to take their own life. They don't have a job, they don't have a resume, but the devil's after these kids. And why is that? Because something has been spoken over that kid and he thinks he's just another. No, he's not just another. He is a son of the Almighty God. The King. And the King's Spirit lives in you, and it lives in you, and lives in you, and lives in you. But instead, we go a different process. Here's the process. Are you ready? In my head. Everybody say, in my head. One more time, say, in my head. The devil would much rather have you be in your head. Now, your head is a good thing. Without it, the Spirit can't become everything it wants to be. Because the Holy Spirit partners with your intellect. That's why you got to read the word. Because just like Arthur doesn't know what's in him, Arthur has to go back and find out what is this battle all about? What happened? So this is the importance of coming to church like this and finding out what it is God spoke over you. Why you matter? Where you fit? Why did he give something as powerful as his Spirit in people in Pierce County? Why would he give it to people that have been divorced 2 or 3 times? Why would he give it to people who struggle with addiction? Why would he give it to people with our level of education? Why would he give it to people with our personalities? Don't you want to know that? Well, it's in the book. So we read and we engage our mind, we use our mind. We don't want to be dumb people. We want to be smart people. But you can't live in your head because your head is just about thinking. And the Spirit isn't exclusively thinking. It uses your thinking. But sometimes the Holy Spirit asks you to go beyond your thinking. Beyond. I was driving one time, I was driving on 6th Avenue, and I just passed what used to be Kmart. Now it's kind of empty. There's a Sonic there. I orient my whole life around fast food restaurants in this town. You know where I'm talking about. Don't judge me. And I have this name pop up in my head. It's a gal, her name is Shelley. And I hadn't seen Shelley in 20 years. I'm thinking, oh, I wonder if that's odd. Why would I think about her? And I had something, it wasn't in my head, it was in my spirit. Say, call her. In my head says, I don't even know her number. Da, da, da. In my spirit says, call her. So I thought, well, I'll dig up her parents. So I call around, I get her parents' number, call the parents, I get the number from the parents, I call her, she lives on the East Coast, or someplace like that. And I finally get a hold of her. I get a hold of her voicemail. And I say, Shelley, it's Dean. And I was thinking about you today, and I want you to know I'm praying for you, and I'm thinking about you, and I don't even know why I'm calling. We haven't talked in decades. Just know I'm rooting for you. I didn't hear from her that day. I didn't hear from her the next day. A week and a half or so later, I get a call from her. She's crying. And she says, I want you to know what you did for me. I'm in the middle of a custody battle, and my husband abducted my son an hour before you called. And my mind said, coincidence! But my spirit says, divine appointment. If I'm in my head, I can rationalize it away. You can rationalize it away. What are the odds? It's just luck in my head. But I'm not just in my head. Let me give you another one. How about this? In my feelings. You can live your whole life in your feelings. Your feelings have a small tether to your head, but a lot of people fake the head part and they just totally run on feelings. So they attend church when they're feeling good or when they're feeling really bad, and then you don't see them again until they have another celebration or a disaster. And I know, I don't take it personal. Lots of people are in their feelings. Lots of people. When you feel like giving up, or when you feel like this or feel like that, and I have feelings too. Our feelings sometimes are clues that we need to fix something. But you can't run in your feelings. You have to supplement your feelings with the Holy Spirit. It says, I don't feel like going, but I know God has an appointment for me. I felt like I was supposed, this is what I say things like this all the time. I don't want to go. I don't even know why I said yes to going. Does anybody know what I'm talking about here? But I felt like I was supposed to go. And I have never been disappointed because I ignored my feelings. The enemy will use your feelings against you. Your feelings will lie to you. Your feelings say, this marriage is irredeemable. I know. Feelings are like that. But you know what? That's not necessarily the truth. I could be in my head. I could be in my feelings. What's another option? Do you have another option? I could be in my spirit. I can be in my spirit. I could be in my circumstances. That's what it was. My circumstances is not my thinking or my emotions. It's just my facts. It's like, we're always going to be broke. Why? Well, because this fact and that fact and that fact. Oh, I know. But sometimes the spirit can trump facts. So, I mean, lots of times people have said to me, I have stage 4. And that's the medical community's way of saying, stop hoping. The facts are the facts. But I can fill this room pretty well. Pretty well fill this room with people who were stage 4. And the spirit had another say. The Holy Spirit is Jesus in us doing miracles. miracles in our head, miracles in our feelings, miracles in our circumstances, but it's allowing him. So a lot of times when you read the Bible, there's people speaking in tongues, like what in the world? And they call that being, you know, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit is from another kingdom, and every kingdom has a language. You know that, right? Every kingdom. You go to Spain, what do they speak? Thank you, Spanish. You're the only one with me, bro. I need you so bad right now, I gotta tell you. If I go to Brazil, what do they speak in Brazil? They speak Portuguese. Okay, here's the trick question. Here's the trick question. What nation conquered Spain? The Spanish nation. Who conquered Brazil? The Portuguese. This isn't hard. When a kingdom takes over, it inserts its language. And when the kingdom takes over Dean, the Holy Spirit inserts his language. And it starts living out the priorities of the kingdom. And the kingdom of God, when the Holy Spirit comes in you and you start activating it and you didn't even know it, you put your hand on that sword and something comes through you and something comes through it and you start having different priorities. It's the priorities of the kingdom. It's the language of the kingdom. It's the works of the kingdom. Because I can't heal cancer, but when I pray, Holy Spirit work in that body. Sometimes the Holy Spirit says, now. Sometimes when we pray, God, change his heart, convict him, turn that husband back to his family. We are asking for the priorities of the kingdom to come now. Now, when we pray, somebody's in addiction. And when you're in addiction, all you are is in your body. You're in your feelings. And you go, I feel like I gotta have this stuff. I mean, you feel like if you don't have another Budweiser, it's like, is that real, by the way? No, it's in your, you're in your feelings. You're in your feelings. But we pray kingdom priorities. We pray, God, break the grip of that stuff in him, in her. I know this is rudimentary to some, but you know what? I think a whole lot of people, even Jesus people, go back to counterfeit stuff because they don't operate in the Spirit enough. I know Jesus people who read their horoscope every day to find out what kind of day they're gonna have. I put that in the category of little pieces of mirror in my window to keep the bad boogeyman out. The Spirit of God lives in you, girl. The Holy Spirit of Jesus lives in you, man. You don't need to look at the USA Today to figure out what kind of day you're going to have. It's in you. It's in you. It's in you. You know what they call alcohol, by the way? Spirits. You knew that, right? I believe it's a counterfeit spirit. I believe everything that Jack Daniels wants to do for you, the Holy Spirit is trying to do the same thing. Only we don't want to wait on the Holy Spirit. We want instant peace. We want instant connection and being more gregarious. But whatever a counterfeit can do for you, the Holy Spirit of Jesus can do for you if you just invite him in. Let's do it right now. Let's do it right now. I know it's going to be a risk, but just close your eyes for a second. And let's just believe right now that what I said was so, that the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of Jesus. It is a personalization of God, the God of Jupiter and Saturn, the God that created these beautiful trees and the spring flowers that are on their way. In my yard, like every day, I could see those flowers come up a little more. The timing, the design, the miracle of it all. In the same way, God put things in you that are about to bloom. And I'm going to pray that the Holy Spirit, like the cool movie, you put your hand on this thing, something powerful is going to come through you. We invite the Holy Spirit to come in, get us out of our head, get us out of our feelings, get us out of our circumstances, get us out of our fears, get us out of our suicidal tendencies, get us out of our divorce thinking, get us out of our self-pity, get us out. The Holy Spirit calls you who you were meant to be. Every head bowed and every eye closed right now, just say, Holy Spirit. Just talk to him. Just say that out loud. Just say, Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, come through me. Come through me. Invigorate my life. Give me ideas and power. You know what? He has a language. You could speak in tongues tonight. It doesn't have to be whiz bang. Woo. Just the language of the kingdom is different. Pray right now that God could bring his healing through you, that he could bring his language through you, that he could bring his wisdom through you, that he could give you words of knowledge, that he could tell you somebody to call when you weren't even thinking about it. You haven't seen him in 2 decades, but he could put you in the right place at the right time. The Holy Spirit can tell you exactly how much to do and where to do it. Holy Spirit, do that personalization tonight. Tonight in these people, that they could know how good you are, Holy Spirit. That they could know how good you are. I pray, let it be so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Creation knows the voice that's spoken to the void. The breath that brought the dust to life and sang the stars to form. The darkness fears your voice that drove it back before. And though the night is long, I know your light, come on, we'll drive it back once more. One word from you, things change on your authority. Your word is true. Things change on your authority. My fight is not my own. Its end is in your hands. I worship you because I know all things, come on, must bow to your command. We
Will heaven not prevail? Come on.
the strongholds not be moved, will spirits not be silenced, and cower at his roar? For if my God is for me, then what have I to fear?